Well, welcome to CrossPoint Online. I'm so glad you guys would join us today, and Happy New Year. Man, 2017 is kicked off today, and so glad that you guys would join us. Hey, a couple things today that you gotta know. We have a lady that's gonna be speaking with us today. Her name is Lisa Harper. If you know her, you know how much fun she is. If you don't, there's three things that could happen. One, you're gonna cry today. Two, you're gonna laugh today. Or three, you're gonna do both of those at the same time. Just be careful when you take a drink of your coffee because it could come out your nose. You've been warned. So that being said, before she comes to be a part of speaking to us today, we're actually going to do worship together. And so if you're in your pajamas or in your living room, in your car, experiencing this, for sometimes it can feel a little weird worshiping to a screen, but we have the words at the bottom and we would love for you to engage with what God has for you today. So I wanna welcome you to CrossPoint.
Yeah.
So glad that you guys are here today. Man, happy new year. One of the things that I love bragging about with you guys, about you guys all the time, is the way that you give. You are the most generous people I know. And we get that crazy opportunity all the time to see our city and our country being impacted by the way that you give. And so if you want to give today, there's two ways you can do that. You can go to crosspoint.tv/give, or you can click the give button right there on your screen, and we would love for that to happen. So one of the ways that I love talking about us as a church and what you get to be a part of is one of the things we do called Dollar Club. We get to do this once a month. And Dollar Club is a way that we give a dollar above our tithes and offerings that go to something in our city and also our world. And so last month, if you missed December, if you missed what we did in December, you missed a big deal. And so we don't want you to miss that. And we want to share with you what your giving gave to. So check this out.
wildfires fueled by record dry conditions. They are burning through the Great Smoky Mountains and threatening cities and tourist sites in eastern Tennessee.
Our it is believed that more than 14,000 storm damage
nothing
over the
we
years.
Can do. All of our stuff, everything like is gone. 25 years I've lived here and I've never seen anything like it.
What this fire has done to this area.
Today, thousands of people forced out of their homes were allowed back home to see what was left.
Careful, your old nails sticking up everywhere. So.
This corner was Mandy's bedroom. Then you had the living room. Most of that end of the house was a family room with big, huge, large windows that looked out onto the view.
Hey, CrossPoint, I'm Micah Stevens.
And hey, Faith Promise, I'm Ashley Eicher, and this is a very special Christmas edition of the Dollar Club, our opportunity to give just $1 and see the amazing things that can happen when we all do good together.
And we knew that CrossPoint was going to do this. I knew all the generous people at Faith Promise wanted to be a part so that we can help a very special family, the Huskies.
Mike and Melissa, thank you so much for just taking some time to share your story with both of us. Can you just walk us through those days and hours and minutes leading up to when you had to evacuate?
The morning that it actually happened, I woke up, looked outside, and everything was yellow. There was just a yellow glow.
So I come home, I start putting up all our Christmas decorations. We decorated the house that weekend. Start putting up the decorations, and I just happened to glance out the window. And I saw a fire truck drive by. So I called a friend of mine who lives close by and asked him if he knew what was going on. And he said, yes, the mountain is on fire above my house and we're evacuating. And so I go to help him and we get some things out of his house and get him evacuated. And once they're safe, I come home. And like I said, when I pulled in my driveway, the bottom of the driveway is on fire. I was able to get 3 armloads of clothes. The time that was done, it was probably a time frame of 5 minutes. The house is surrounded, and I get to the bottom of the driveway, and it's just by the grace of God I made it, I guess. The only thing I could do, I jumped out of the truck and just immediately fell on my knees. I've never really been afraid of much, but I can honestly say that was the first time I've ever been afraid.
When you felt the fire, when you felt stuff of your life being consumed, what mattered most to you in those moments?
That Melissa and Mandy were safe.
Yeah.
That was all I could think about.
She calls me and she's like, Mandy, we have to go. It's at the house. Mm-hmm. So I go in, I panic. We're driving there and I remember as we pulled up to the driveway, I saw the mountain on fire and I screamed. I just screamed. Like, I didn't know what else to do besides scream. So I screamed, I pulled up into the driveway, I got out of the car and just, it was so surreal. Like, I didn't think this was actually happening to me.
Right.
I never thought anything like this would happen to me.
Right.
Tell us a little bit about how you feel about your parents and how has that changed? Has it changed your relationship at all?
I've realized that I am so lucky to have the parents that I do have. I'm so grateful for them. They are the best parents anyone could ask for. Like, I don't know what I would do without them.
That's nice.
So I know that Micah and our friends at Faith Promise told you that we just wanted to come in to interview you guys and get your story. Mm-hmm. And that's part of the truth. But at CrossPoint, we have this thing called the Dollar Club. And once a month, we ask everybody in the church to throw in an extra dollar, pull all that money together, and find a need in the community that needs to be filled. And so for this month, we want you guys to be in your family the recipient of the Dollar Club. So we want to take you all on a shopping spree to get whatever it is that you need for Christmas. And if that's gifts for each other, so you have things that you can surprise each other with that morning, whether it's a spatula, whatever it is that you need to just continue and have a really amazing Christmas.
Yes.
In light of everything that's gone on in the last couple of weeks. So there's one more thing. In addition to that, because there's a lot of surprises around here. CrossPoint and Faith Promise also partnered together on the Stoller Club because we want to give you guys a check for $12,000. Yeah, well, hopefully that will, whether it's to go towards a down payment on a new house or it is whatever you feel like your immediate needs are, that it will take care of some of that. And again, to help you guys and your family in this process.
Praise the Lord.
Do you feel like that will be helpful?
We want that check to just be a part so you can continue to rebuild.
So there's one more thing.
Oh, you're killing me. You're killing me.
So we obviously know that you are an incredible dancer, and we've talked about that. And we were also told that there is a dance competition that you are going to this summer in Florida that you want to go to. And I know it's been a conversation about how are we going to do that in light of everything that's happening. So in addition to obviously taking care of you getting to Orlando and the competition, we want to send your whole family on an all expense paid trip to Disney World so that you all can just, as you're going through this rebuilding process, you can also continue to make some amazing memories together as well.
Thank you so much.
I'm very sneaky.
Yeah. Oh my gosh.
Yeah, those words are, Thank you so much. I'm gonna hear those words rustling.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Merry
Christmas. There you go. Besties.
Church, thank you. Because of you, we get to impact people all around the world. And so thank you for being a part of what Jesus is doing. And so we're so grateful to be a part of that. Also, I want you to put on your calendars, January 4th at 6:30, we're doing an event called One Church. We're all gonna meet at the Nashville location. All campuses are gonna meet here, and we're gonna get to celebrate what God did in the past, what God is currently doing in the present, and what God has for us in the future. I think it'll be an amazing opportunity for you to reset and say, God, what do you want to do in 2017 in my life? But also, what do you want to do through our church? And so I hope that you'll join us for that. The last thing that I have to tell you about is January 8th. We have a brand new series called Second Wind. And for a lot of you, maybe it's been a year for you that you need to start over and a redo. But I want you to check this out and see more about what Second Wind's all about.
It's an experience known to be very real and very powerful. This catching your second wind is just as mysterious of an occurrence as it is euphoric. You think you're completely out of gas. You fought as hard as you can to keep going, and you just don't have any more steam left. Then, suddenly, you're exhilarated and carried effortlessly into a burst of this extraordinary energy. You are seconds away from doubling over and giving up. And then you're able to press on and you feel even more energized than when you first started. Whatever it is, it gets unlocked in those moments of almost total exhaustion. You've worked hard to get to this point, but you're not sure you're gonna make it, and then suddenly you blow past it, and before you know it, you've gone farther than you ever thought possible. And you're still not stopping. Breathe deep. Press forward. This is your second wind.
So you're not gonna wanna miss it. So invite your friends, your crazy uncle, everybody you know, get them here for January 8th for this brand new series. It's gonna be incredible. Well, today, would you guys give a big welcome to Lisa Harper?
Hey y'all, I'm Lisa Harper. I'm so tickled to be back at CrossPoint. Y'all know I'm pathologically biased when it comes to your house. Before we dive into this New Year's message, I want to ask you to just bow and pray with me for a second. Jesus, 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 we acknowledge that you are the giver of all things good. And so, Lord, as we walk into, run into, some of us are stumbling and wobbling into 2017. Lord, we pray that through your Holy Spirit, you would take the veils off our eyes and the scales off our ears and any hardness off our hearts so that we could see and hear and understand you more fully this next season. Help us to risk everything for you, Jesus, because you are truly worth it. We love you and praise you. Amen. And before I dive into this message this morning, I want to talk especially to those of you who are viewing along with a computer, your online viewing. I know, because the Holy Spirit told me, that some of y'all also have an Amazon screen up, and some of y'all have iTunes up, and some of y'all are probably watching a movie. You need to shut those boxes down, baby, because we've already prayed here in the house that y'all will get hives or some kind of dreadful skin disease if you do not just do this one screen, not because of me, but because what God is going to do through His Word. So shut out Amazon, quit online shopping for deals. Let's just zoom in to Jesus. We're going to be looking at Luke chapter 2, because there's a story that took place 8 days after that very first Christmas. So it's kind of the first New Year's story. It's what would happen tomorrow. It's 8 days after Christmas. But before we go there, I want to tell you a little story of my own, because I've been here before and y'all have been so kind to me. Most of you know that I'm a relatively new adoptive mom. I brought my little girl home from Haiti 2.5 years ago. I'm 53, so I went through motherhood and menopause at the same time. That was just God's double portion of blessing in my life. But because I'm an older, kind of new mom, I've realized, you know, I don't have the time to read 550 parenting books. I've got to kind of distill my parenting wisdom down to something that's kind of simple that I can actually walk out, that Missy can understand. She's from Haiti, so English is a second language. So we have three rules as in the Harper household. There's just two of us. I don't have a daddy yet. I would love to have a baby daddy. So if you have any employed older brothers, that would be cool. 1-800-588. Please call Lisa for a date. Anyway, here's our three rules in the Harper household. It is, you have to be kind, you have to be polite and respectful, and you have to have fun. That's basically the three rules of being a Harper, and that's what I try to encourage in Missy every single day. She's 7. Well, the other day, this happened 2 weeks ago, we fly a lot. I travel quite a bit, and Missy travels with me. I'm homeschooling her so she can go on the road with me. And we were in the airport. We were in a public restroom. And she's at that place, and some of y'all who have kids this age, you know, they get into a real privacy mode where they don't want to go in the, and we call it the condo, the handicapped restroom. She don't want to go in there with mama. She wants to go into a stall by herself. And I understand that. I want her to be independent. So when we go into the airport restroom, she said, "Mama, I want my own space." I said, "I know, baby." I said, "There's a stall right there. You go in that one and I'll go into this stall." Well, part of what I've taught her in the rule number 2 is when we're in public, part of being polite and being respectful is there's some things that you only do in the privacy of the restroom, and you don't talk about that. So that's been just ingrained in her really since I brought her home from Haiti. But then I also tell her, "Baby, you're always honest with mama. You just tell mama everything. She can tell me everything." So she goes into her restroom. I go into my restroom, these little stalls at the Dallas airport. And there's other people in there. I mean, you can see their shoes. I know y'all do the same thing. And so there's women around us. There's probably, I don't know, you know, 12 people maybe in the restroom. And we have our little, I don't know, 30 seconds of restroom time. And then the woman, so she's 2 stalls away from me. She's next to Missy. I hear this woman. Everyone hears this woman because she, I want to be careful since we're in church. She'd probably eaten Mexican food the night before. So she was having some, she was just vigorous in the restroom. And so after this woman is vigorous, but in the privacy of her own stall, which is appropriate, my kid with this unmistakable Haitian accent bellows in the restroom, "Mama, that lady just passed gas in public. That's trashy, right, mama?" So after I whisked her out of the restroom without washing her hands and we were headed to our gate, I was like, "Baby, there's another rule. Here's the rule. Timing is everything." Trying to teach Missy, there's some places where you just have to wait for it. Timing is important. As we're going into the new year, I thought time and timing and waiting would be a good theme, an appropriate theme for this New Year's 2017. And there's a passage that's all about timing and waiting, that this is the 8 days after the first Christmas passage. It's in Luke 2. So it's right after the shepherds and the babe born in Bethlehem. This is 8 days later. It begins in Luke chapter 2, verse 22. "And when the time came for their purification according to the law of Moses," now that is 8 days after Jesus was born, according to Mosaic law, it was incumbent upon Mary and Joseph to go to the temple and have a ceremonial sacrifice on behalf of their firstborn son. That's what this is talking about. They brought him, Jesus, up to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord, as it is written in the law of the Lord, every male who first opens the womb shall be called holy to the Lord, and to offer a sacrifice according to what is said in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons. Verse 25. Now there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon, and this man was righteous and devout, waiting for the consolation of Israel. And the Holy Spirit was upon him, and it had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Christ. And he came in the Spirit into the temple. And when the parents brought in the child, Jesus, to do for him according to the custom of the law, he took him up in his arms and blessed God and said, or it would actually be a better translation, and sang, because the words that come next were actually a song that Simeon sang. Lord, now you're letting your servant depart in peace according to your word, for my eyes have seen your salvation, that you have prepared in the presence of all peoples, a light for the revelation to the Gentiles, for the glory to your people Israel. And his father and his mother marveled at what was said about him. And Simeon blessed them and said to Mary, his mother, behold, this child is appointed for the fall and rising of many in Israel and for a sign that is opposed. And a sword will pierce through your own soul also, so that thoughts from many hearts may be revealed. And there was a prophetess, Anna, the daughter of Phanuel of the tribe of Asher. She was advanced in years. That's kind of putting it mildly, having lived with her husband 7 years from when she was a virgin and then as a widow until she was 84, she did not depart from the temple, worshiping with fasting and prayer night and day. And coming up at that very hour, she began to give thanks to God and to speak of him to all who are waiting for the redemption of Jerusalem. Now, y'all forgive me. I know that was a really long passage, but let me kind of put it in modern context for you. We're told that Simeon, this man, that the Holy Spirit has told him, you will not depart from Israel until you see the glory of Israel, Emmanuel. You'll see the Messiah. So it's implied that he's old, because it would be weird for like a 25-year-old to go, I will not depart until I see the glory of Israel. So it's implied that he's old. Most New Testament scholars think he's an old guy. Then Anna, when I said it's, you know, putting it mildly, that they say she's advanced in age, if you do the math, it says she married and then she was widowed after 7 years and then she's been a widow for, I think it says 84 years. If you do the math, most Jewish girls in the first century married at 14 or 15. That means Anna is 104 or 105. She's got an old man and a very old woman. And both of them have received the promise decades before, you're not going to die until you meet the Messiah. You are not going to end your life until you see the Christ. You will see the glory of Israel. She's 104, 105. Can you imagine what she's thinking? I mean, they live across the street at the OJ, Old Jewish People Retirement Home. Won't that be OJPRH? They both live across the street there, and we're told by Luke that they spend most of their time in the temple. So every day she wakes up and she texts Simeon, their friends. They do crosswords together. There's nothing romantic there because they're too old, but they're buddies. And they cross the street together and then they both volunteer at the temple. And they've been doing this for decades because they're so advanced in age. So those of us who go to temple to worship, we're used to seeing them there. They're there all the time. He's kind of like the volunteer janitor. He's got high water khakis. He always wears the same blue button down, real sweet, kind of stooped, white hair, pocket protector with a bunch of pencils, you know, the old fashioned cell phone on a clip on his belt. And he kind of shuffles around. He's going down to the basement, getting candles to put up at the altar. Anna, she's 104, 105. She always smells like pledge. You know, she's usually polishing the pews. I mean, they're this sweet old couple you always see in the temple. So most people didn't pay attention. Most people either disregarded them. They might give them a polite hello, or they were kind of invisible to others because they've been there forever. They're kind of just like, you know, the stained glass windows. You just get so used to them. But can you imagine what had gone through their minds year after year? As more and more of their friends die, until it seems like it's only Simeon and Anna who are waiting to see the Christ. Waiting is hard, isn't it? I mean, waiting can be so hard. Three Christmases ago, I'd been told that summer that I would bring Missy home from Haiti, that the adoption was finally going to go through. And I had lost two adoptions prior to Missy, so my heart was already a little bit plowed up. And I remember getting so excited when they told me in August that I was going to get to bring her home before Christmas, that I went out and I bought these two stockings, went to a store that's pricier than the normal stores I get stockings from, found these beautiful stockings, and one I got Missy embroidered on it, and the other one I got Mama embroidered on it. I was 50 years old that year. I couldn't believe that finally, after all those years, I was actually going to have a kid's stocking on my mantle. I was so excited that just in case they turn, you know, stockings turn all the time on the mantle, I had them embroidered on the other side. So that both sides would show Missy and Mama. I'm telling you, I like was singing Black Eyed Peas on the way home with these stockings in like September. I was so excited. I thought, I'm going to go ahead and decorate. It's time to decorate the house for Christmas. Because I was so excited that I was going to be bringing my little girl home. And they called me in October and they said, Lise, you're not going to bring her home for Christmas after all this year. As a matter of fact, because of some of the laws that are changing in Haiti, it looks like there's a chance she won't get to bring her home ever. And I can still remember, y'all, I had hung those stockings in October. I started to decorate in October because I thought it'll be so busy in December when I'm going down to get her and bring her home that I won't have time to decorate for Christmas. So I'm going to go ahead and decorate early this year. And I'd already hung those stockings. And I don't even have words to wrap around what it felt like to take them off the mantle. I rolled them up in a box and I put them in the back of a closet underneath the stairs because I thought I don't ever want to see them again. There's so much heartbreak in the fact that I'm not only not getting to bring her home for Christmas, but I may never get to bring this daughter that I've grown to love so deeply. Her last name was Artie Harper. I may never bring her home from Haiti. I'm telling you, that was the longest Christmas of my life. That season was the longest waiting I've ever done. And I'm 50. I can't imagine being 104. 104 and still waiting, 104 and still clinging to what surely to everybody else sounded foolish. The Holy Spirit told me I would see the Christ before I died. And then we're told after Jesus was born in Bethlehem, 8 days later, his teenage mama, Mary was probably 14 or 15, and his daddy, Joe, went to the temple, as was Jewish custom. We're told that you could bring a pair of turtle doves or a pair of pigeons to sacrifice to the Lord according to the law of Moses for your firstborn son. They were poor, so they couldn't afford turtle doves. They had pigeons. So just imagine a 19-year-old guy, kind of sheepish. He's got a backpack. He's got pigeons rustling and squawking in his backpack, and you've got a 14-year-old little girl who barely knows how to hold a baby, but she's holding this brand new baby, teeny baby boy, the Son of God. And they kind of sheepishly push open the temple doors because it's a Tuesday morning. There's nobody at temple that day. Most of the priests are busy doing the business of the Lord. It's just Simeon up near the front of the altar. He's putting out new candles. He hears the door creak and he turns around and he sees this teenage couple with a squawking backpack and a baby. And in that moment, Simeon knows, in that moment, that's the Christ. That's who I've been waiting for my whole life. And this old man shuffles down that hallway, that center aisle of the temple, and he approaches Joseph and Mary, and Joseph says, excuse me, sir, I'm sorry to bother you, but my wife and I had our son a week ago, 8 days ago, and we know we're supposed to come and offer a sacrifice to Jehovah, to Yahweh on his behalf. So I've got these birds in my backpack, and I'm not real sure where to go. And Simeon goes, son, I'll tell you in just a second. And he goes, honey, my name is Mr. Simeon. do you mind if I hold your son? And Mary, this brand new mama, places this 8-day-old baby boy that the sins of the world would be upon. Emmanuel, God with us, in the arms of this old man, probably afraid, is he strong enough to hold my son? She's not real secure in the way she holds Jesus yet. Here she's handed him to this man who's advanced in age. She's probably afraid that Simeon's going to drop baby Jesus. Instead, he takes that baby and he cradles that child and he begins to sing. He begins to sing a worship song. Now, Anna, who's 104 years old, she's not in the sanctuary that Tuesday morning. She's refilling the paper towels in the women's restroom. And she hears Simeon begin to sing, but he's so old and it's so off key that it sounds almost exactly the same as the sound he made when he broke his hip a year earlier. So she thinks, oh, my old friend has fallen down again and he's probably hurt. And she's fumbling for her phone thinking, I'm going to need to call 911. As she rushes into the temple, she runs down the aisle and she sees Simeon holding a baby. She sees this teenage couple standing awkwardly beside him. And Anna, in that moment, Luke says, knows the Son of God is here. And she couldn't wait to tell everybody, I have seen the Christ. Y'all, to me, one of the biggest keys to having a happy year, any year, but certainly this year, is learning to wait and trust God in the meantime. Timing is everything. And God's timing is always perfect. It doesn't feel perfect when you roll up stockings that you desperately hoped to be filled with toys for a child who may never come. It may not feel perfect when you're at a church and there's anything that happens that doesn't seem like it should happen in a church. May not feel perfect when that person you loved wasn't at Christmas dinner this year. It may not feel perfect when you're still waiting for a ring on your left hand and you feel like you're moving past child-rearing years. There's so many times that we don't trust the timing of God, and that's what makes our years less than happy. But God's timing is always perfect. I had a hard time trusting God as my Heavenly Father because both my dad and my stepfather were pretty difficult men. My dad left us when I was 5. He left my mom and my sister and I for another woman and her child. And I thought it must be at least partly my fault. I was 5 years old, was devastated by my dad's abandonment, the ensuing divorce, which was very difficult, very acrimonious. I began praying for a new daddy. I thought if only I could get a daddy who wouldn't leave. 2 years later, my dad married a man named John Angel. And I was so excited. I thought, this is the man I've prayed for. When he and Mom were dating, Mom oftentimes would be late when he came to pick her up for a date. So he'd come into the living room and hang out with me. And he'd always bring a bag of bazooka bubblegum. Some of you are old enough to remember the bubblegum wrapped in comics. He would bring a whole bag of it, and we didn't have much money. So the fact he'd bring me like 20 or 25 pieces of bazooka, that was a big deal. And it was also a big deal that he would tell me to make my elbows stiff, and he'd put his hands under my elbows, and he'd lift me all the way up over his head. And I just thought that was amazing. He was a big, strong guy. So the fact that he could lift me over his head, I thought, you know, this is the bomb. He's bringing me gum. He can lift me off my feet. That's actually on my eHarmony profile. That's all you got to do. Bring me gum, lift me off my feet. I thought, this is the man. But I will never forget, 2 years later, they married. They came home from their honeymoon the night before I started the second grade. And at breakfast that morning, I thought, this is a red-letter day. Because I'm starting the second grade. I've got the best teacher at Southside Elementary School, and I've got a dad. I've got a new dad. His name is John Angel. Breakfast that morning, Mom made a big breakfast to celebrate them coming home from their honeymoon. She'd made bacon. I was like, this is the bomb, because I love, you know, pork products. So I was like, this is awesome. Starting the second grade, I've got a new dad. We've got bacon. Like, it doesn't get any better than this. We prayed, and when Mom said amen, my new daddy took his butter knife when I reached for a piece of bacon, and he slapped me across the knuckles. And he pointed at me and he said, "Lisa, girls don't eat bacon because bacon will make you fat and men don't like fat women." And that was the first time as a 7-year-old little girl that I kind of clued into the fact that maybe the man my mama dated wasn't the man who moved into our home. And I began to call my stepfather. And our relationship was not a great daddy-daughter relationship. I was desperate for him to love me. He was a hard man. Loved me as best he could, but it really left me wanting. So you can probably imagine when I got a phone call 8 years ago and my aunt said, "Lisa, you need to get home as quickly as you can." I grew up in Central Florida. She said, "You need to get home as quickly as you can because John has suffered a stroke and the doctors are saying he's probably not going to make it through the night." I was just desperate to see my stepdad before he died. I was at a women's conference in Denver, Colorado. I mean, I was terrified flying to Orlando. It took a while to get there that he would die as I was en route. As soon as we landed, I called the house, and Darlene said, "Lisa, you are not going to believe this. John has not only survived, but the doctors are saying he has done so well. He's recovered most of his speech, all of his movement. They're saying he's probably going to be released from the hospital in 2 days. And she said, it's a miracle. Well, sure enough, 2 days later, my stepdad is released from the hospital. We're sitting across from each other 3 days later at the kitchen table, same table he had whacked my knuckles at. And he looked up and he said, "Now, where did you come from to get here?" And I said, "I was in Denver, Dad. I was at an event in Denver." And he said, "What event in Denver?" And I said, "Well, it was an event called Women of Faith." I said, "Dad, it's a women's conference. You know, I've told you about it before that I'm involved with, where a lot of women come together and we talk about how much God loves us." And he went, "Oh, yeah, that's good." Now, for my dad to say that's good about something to do with God was just shocking, because my dad was a vehement agnostic. As a matter of fact, when I was a senior in high school, he had taken my Bible and he had thrown it, pitched it out our front door in the rain and said, "I don't want that bull blank in my house anymore." When I told him I was going to go to work in youth ministry after undergrad, he said, "Yours is the biggest waste of a mind I've ever seen." He said, "I can't believe you're going to spend the rest of your life talking to people about Jesus who wasn't God." My dad hated anything to do with God. So when he said, "That's good," I was just shocked. Well, then I realized my mom was standing behind my dad and she was motioning for me to come go with her. So I excused myself from talking with Dad and I went over to my mom and she said, "Come here, I have got to show you something in the basement." My dad had an office in the basement. She took me down to the basement. There's his desk, and it is covered with Bibles, y'all. There's like 8 Bibles on my dad's desk and 2 devotional books that he'd pilfered from my mom's room upstairs. And she said, "Lisa, this is all your dad has been reading for the last 3 or 4 months." She said, "All he wants to do is read the Bible and read these devotional books." And then she said, "Honey, I think your dad has become a Christian." And I was like, "I think you've been taking some of his meds," because I thought, there's no way. I mean, there's no stinking way. My dad, he's too mean. And he's too prideful. He's too prejudiced. There's no way my dad has put his hope in Jesus. But I thought, Mom's been through so much. It's been so difficult being his caregiver. And Dad was so, he's just a rough man. And so I thought, just to appease Mom, I was like, "Oh, sure," thinking to myself, "there's no way." And she said, "Honey, why don't you go upstairs and ask him to read the Bible to you?" She said, "I think if you ask, he'll read it." And I thought, she is smoking something. I mean, there's no way my dad's going to read the Bible. He threw my Bible out in the yard. But I thought, again, just to appease my sweet mama, I'll do it. So I go upstairs and I said, "Hey, Dad, would you mind reading the Bible to me?" And he went, "Why?" And I thought, now there's the dad. I know. And I said, "Well, because it's my favorite book and yours is my favorite voice." And he said, "Okay." Again, I was just so taken aback. So Mom hurriedly got a Bible. She put it in my dad's lap. He's sitting as lazy boy. He starts thumbing through the Bible. And while he's thumbing through the Bible, I reached over real quick and I flipped it to John chapter 14. Because I thought, if this is the only time I hear my dad read God's word, I want to hear him say, it's only by faith in Jesus that we're reconciled with God the Father. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Lord but by me. Not that I have control issues or anything. And so my dad starts reading at John 14, and y'all, he read all the way through John's gospel, all the way to John 20. And the only time he stopped, the first time he stopped, was when I interrupted him. I was recording the whole thing on my iPhone. I still have this. I have it backed up on two hard drives. My dad read all the way through John's gospel till I stopped him at John 20. And y'all know that's the part in John's gospel where Thomas sees a resurrected Jesus. This is after the crucifixion and resurrection, but before the ascension. And Thomas was a doubter. So when he sees Jesus, he says, "How can I know it's you?" And our Redeemer says, "Thomas, touch my hand. Touch the nail print in my hand and you'll know it's me." Well, when my dad read that part in the story, I interrupted him. I said, "Hey, Dad, do you believe?" And he said, "What do you mean?" And I said, "Well, Dad, you're so much like Thomas was. You're really bright. You're very analytical. But you have never encountered a flesh and blood Messiah. So it would take a lot of faith for you to believe in Jesus, for you to put your hope in Jesus. Do you believe?" And he was quiet for, it was probably only 3 or 4 seconds. But you know, when you're waiting for something and it goes on forever, it felt like it was 3 or 4 minutes. And then he looked up at me. My dad had these crystal clear blue eyes. He just looked straight into my eyes and he said, "Yes, I do." And I was just like, couldn't believe it. I think I just slipped my pants. I was so excited. I thought, I cannot believe my dad has put his hope in Jesus. And I was still hesitant, y'all, because I thought, I just am not sure. But over the next few days, I could see he has changed. He's not abusive to my mom anymore. I mean, he's different. He's singing hymns in the basement. It was unbelievable. Well, 6 weeks later, I had to go back to work, and they called me again. And my aunt said, "Lise, this time you need to hustle home as fast as you can, because he's had a second stroke and it really looks bad this time." I was in Sacramento, California, another event. Took almost 20 hours to get to Orlando. Had all these flight delays and weather. And it was, I mean, it was the longest 20 hours of my life. Our wheels hit the tarmac. And when we hit the tarmac, I called the house. Dad was in hospice. And the hospice nurse got on the phone. And she said, "Baby, I'm so sorry, but while you were in the air, your father slipped into a coma." And she said, "So you're not going to get to talk to him before he passes." But she said, he's fading quickly, so you need to get here from the airport as fast as you can. The Orlando airport is about an hour from my parents' home. So we hustled to my parents' house. I jumped out of the car while it was still rolling, and I ran up the steps, and I ran to the back bedroom where Dad was in a hospital bed. And someone had told my mom that hearing is the last thing to go. So she had yelled at my dad the last week of his life. And when I ran in the bedroom, at that point, he'd been in a coma for 5 hours. I ran in the bedroom and my mom yelled, "Honey, Lisa's home." And, you know, of course, he hadn't moved for 5 hours. But against all odds, my dad opened his eyes. And then he rolled over onto his left elbow, and he went like this to me. And I walked across the room, and I knelt down in front of my gruff daddy, and he put his arms around me. And the very last thing my father ever said before he passed was, "I love you, Lisa." And I was so undone, because I thought, you know, it's enough that he saved my mean old daddy. I'm convinced there were angels that when Dad landed in glory, they went, "What?" You know, John Angel's here. Anybody can get saved. And of course, that's true. So it was really enough. It was enough that God had redeemed my father. But the fact that he redeemed that part of my little girl heart, that my dad knew how desperate I was to hear my dad say, "I love you," even as a 46-year-old woman, to have our Heavenly Father in His mercy give me that closure, I thought, thank you, thank you, thank you, God. Your timing is perfect. I'm so stinking imperfect in the waiting, but your time is perfect. That's the point of what Peter says in his second letter. Peter, 2 Peter, chapter 3, verse 9, "The Lord is not slow to fulfill his promise, as some count slowness, but is patient towards you, not wishing that any should perish, but that all should reach repentance. I can guarantee you there will be difficult waiting seasons ahead for you in this new year. What will make it happy? What will make it truly happy for all of us is to mature to the point that we trust His timing more than our own desires. That we really, really believe what Paul says in Romans, that all things, ultimately will work for our good and for God's glory. His timing is perfect. His love for us is unconditional. His plans for you, they aren't just good, they are great. Happy, happy New Year. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you that you are not slow in keeping your promises, as some understand slowness to be. But you are gracious, slow to anger, rich in mercy, so that all of us would come to repentance. Amen and amen.
Well, thank you so much for being here today. And also thank you, Lisa, for giving an amazing message. We cannot wait to see you guys back here January 4th at 6:30 for One Church. We love you guys. Have a great day. Bye-bye.